What if there was a way for you to put any Scratch game on your 3DS and just run it? See, I love Scratch. The programming language, not really the website that much. I like how easy it is to just slap a few blocks together and have a nice simple little game. And so wouldn't it be cool if you could just play these games on the 3DS? So I did some research to see if someone had already done this before, and it turns out someone actually did. Except it was actually clickbait, and the only thing this contains is the default Hello World program, just edited to say that, hey, this is a placeholder, but don't worry, it'll be finished soon. It was not finished soon. Apparently they gave up because they didn't actually know how to do the port, and when seeing how hard it was, they instantly gave up. While editing, I found another Scratch 3DS port made in Lua. This one seems further along, but again, it's been a couple months since they updated it. I don't know if they're gonna finish theirs, but it's just something to take a look at and keep an eye out for. So cut to me. Instead of looking at the very obvious warning that trying to do this might be a little hard, I was gonna try to port Scratch to the 3DS anyway. Just think of all the slop you could play on the go! And yeah, in the end, I did actually get a working version of this running. You can take any Scratch project you have, run it on the 3DS with my homebrew app, and with any luck, it'll actually run. In the super early versions of this idea, I actually wanted to recreate the entire Scratch editor so you could make Scratch projects on the 3DS, but I quickly realized that it would be way too much effort to do all that and have only three people use it, but I don't know, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe people do actually want to make Scratch projects on their 3DS. But even still, porting the entire Scratch runtime to a 2011 console seems like an impossible task. Scratch's official runtime is open source, but since Scratch is designed to run on the web, it's all written in JavaScript, and I don't think the 3DS supports JavaScript, at least not any modern version of it, so I can't just copy and paste all the code. So, looks like I'm gonna have to recreate the entire Scratch runtime on my own in C++. Oh boy. Okay, well, what's even inside of a Scratch project anyway? There's images, blocks, sounds, sprites, and they're all saved in this SB3 file, which is actually just a renamed zip file. Unzipping it would reveal all of the assets in your project, as well as a JSON file containing all of the block data. This is the crucial file needed for any of this to work, and surprisingly, it's really easy to read, making my job a lot easier. So what we need to do is somehow be able to have the 3DS unzip the Scratch project and read the JSON file inside. After a bit of research, I figured out that I need to install two libraries to help with this, a zip library for unzipping files, and a JSON library for reading JSON files. Then I wrote some code that unzips the SB3 file and reads the project.json file. It does this by first checking the ROMFS for the file. The ROMFS is basically like a virtual file system for 3DS games. It's where all the assets for games are usually stored, like sounds and sprites. But we can put literally anything in here, including our Scratch project, and when we compile the homebrew, the Scratch project will just be bundled into the one executable file. The problem with only using this approach is that you have to compile the homebrew if you even want to use it, which I know people don't always like doing that. So what my code also does is if there's nothing in the ROMFS, it'll look inside your SD card instead. Surprisingly, all of this worked perfectly, and we now see everything in the JSON file. Now that the 3DS can read everything in a Scratch project, we have to actually tell it what to do with all of this. So I first made a sprite class and made variables for everything sprites have, like sounds, blocks, costumes. Then while the project is loading, I convert every sprite from the JSON file into a new sprite from my sprite class. Then I set all the variables and stuff too. Now that the easy parts are done, I have to start the grueling process of writing code that interprets all 125 Scratch blocks in C++ that's optimized enough to run on a 3DS, which, okay, first off, I knew coming into this that I wasn't gonna port every block over, cloud variables are already off the table. So the first block I decided to tackle was the flag block, since without this, I literally can't do anything else. So I made a function that goes through every sprite and checks if there's a flag block inside. In Scratch, every block is run from top to bottom, so I made another function that runs a block, then once it's finished, runs the block right below it. I rewrote this function because it used to be where every single block would be defined, but towards the end, the function got way too long. So now it's a lot shorter, and all the block definitions are their own separate functions. Anyways, I made a flag block function, and all the flag block really does is run the block below it, so that was easy to implement. The next block I wanted to implement is what I thought would be simple, but would actually lead me down a deep rabbit hole that I would not get out of. You see, this block and many others allow you to type in whatever you want in this little field here, but you can also put certain blocks inside, variables, it can have letters in it, or maybe it can have only numbers in it. And in the JSON, it has different ways of dealing with all of these different use cases. So I had to make yet another function that deciphers all this and have it return a value that I can use in the block functions. After that, it was actually pretty easy to make this block, so just like that, we have our first two blocks running. But to actually see what's going on, I started writing some code that would actually render the sprites on the top screen. For now, I made them all render as black squares. We'll come to images a little later. For now, I'll go back to coding more blocks, and I thought it would be easy from now on to code more of these blocks, and it was for a while until I hit the repeat block, and every other block that runs over multiple frames. You see, these blocks run once, and then waits until the next frame of the game, runs again each frame until some condition is met, then goes to the next block. My code up until this point was only made for blocks that run once and then never again, so I had to make new logic for these types of blocks. I ended up making a vector for blocks that need repeating, and for any blocks that need it, I'll just add it to this vector. Then every frame, I'll run them with this function, and once the condition is met, like for the repeat block, once it repeats 10 times, it'll get removed from the vector and stop running. Now, you would think that would be it, and I thought it was too, but in came the millions of edge cases. Like, did you know that only one repeat block can be running in a chain of blocks like this? Like here, it'll run this repeat once, then run the repeat inside of it 10 times until going back to the repeat on top again. Little things like this that you might have known while you're coding in Scratch, but when you're making a custom Scratch interpreter, it goes completely over your head at first. So obviously, I had to add a bunch of random edge cases like that into the system, which was a headache. After that, I did a bit of off-camera programming to get more of the blocks in, enough of them to where I felt confident enough to stop coding in blocks for now and start the nightmare difficulty task of making actual images render to the screen. I already knew from the start that I wasn't even gonna try messing with vector images or SVGs. You're gonna have to convert them to bitmap on your own, buddy. This still leaves me with a huge problem. Homebrew devs strongly recommend converting your images into sprite sheets while compiling the game, and there's no DevKit Pro examples of dynamically loading images on the 3DS. I honestly thought I was cooked because there's no way I'm gonna figure out how to do this on my own. That is until I stumbled across a forum article about this same issue, and they had solved it by converting any normal image on your SD card into a Citra 2D image using some, and I quote, swizzle magic. So I did a bit of stealing and used that in my project. Now, while loading the game, I have to first convert every image into pixel data, then use the code from the forum to convert that pixel data into an image that can actually be rendered by the 3DS. The problem with this is that every image will just sit in memory, and if there's too many images in memory, the 3DS will just crash. So I changed it to only loading the image when the sprite needs it, like when switching costumes, then I delete the image from memory when it's not used anymore. The new problem with this is that deleting and recreating images all the time while the game is running is really slow. So I had to come up with a simple middle ground solution. It'll still load the images when a sprite needs it, but it won't instantly delete it when it's not using it. Instead, it'll wait until there's a certain amount of images in memory. So now if you're constantly switching costumes, it won't have to reload the image every single time. After pretty much the biggest hurdle done, I went back to just implementing more of the blocks. Here's a small rapid fire of a couple of interesting blocks. The cloning blocks were a little hard to do because creating and deleting clones is very slow to do on the 3DS, so what I did was make a huge pool of 300 clones ready to be used whenever, and whenever a clone needed to be made, it'll just pick a random clone in the pool, put all the data it needs inside this new clone, and just use it. And when the clone doesn't need to be used anymore, it'll just get put back into the pool, ready for another sprite to use. The touching block I implemented a little differently, because in Scratch, the collision is like super accurate, like down to the pixel, I think. The 3DS probably can't handle all that, and I wouldn't know how to implement it that way anyway, so I just did simple box collision. This will probably break some projects, but deal with it, I guess. Custom blocks I thought would be harder since you can put any number of arguments inside, but it actually wasn't that hard. I just add every variable it has, and when there's a block that needs the value of the variable, I made a function that grabs it easily. The harder part came with the run without screen refresh option. That makes it so that instead of your repeat blocks running once, then waiting until the next frame to run again, it'll just keep running in the same frame until the whole chain of blocks is done. It wasn't hard to implement this behavior, but again, I had to think of all the edge cases, and that's what made it hard to fully implement it. There's a ton of blocks that I really wanted to add support for, but just couldn't figure out how, like costume effects. Most of these effects I'd probably have to learn how to write shaders for, which I don't want to do all that. But even the simple effects like the color and ghost effects I thought would be a slam dunk, since Citro 2D has what's called image tints that you can use to easily change the color of your image, but I couldn't figure out how to actually use them, probably since I'm using a custom image loading solution, so. Another thing that I couldn't get working yet was sound. I got it half working after a few days of really trying, but it was really unstable and would crash like all the time, so I scrapped it for now, and I'm trying to do more research on the topic, but there's surprisingly little about 3DS audio, so it's a bit hard to learn. A neat little extra thing I did implement though was bottom screen support. Scratch doesn't natively support this, but if you use a Scratch mod like Turbo Warp to make your games, you can change things like the resolution and the frame rate, so I added the ability in my code for it to read the resolution and the frame rate, and if you set the resolution to this specific number, it'll enable the bottom screen. And yeah, after that, we're pretty much done. Now, are there still a ton of bugs in here? Yeah. The majority of games I made in the past that I tried to run on here either crashes or doesn't work correctly. I'm still trying to fix all of these bugs, but for now, I recommend really simple games made with the homebrew's limitations in mind. But hey, when it works, it really does work. On the new 3DS with its extra CPU power, it runs my test project, which has a bunch of math, clones, custom blocks. It runs all of this without issue. On the old 3DS, it does work, but it does have a noticeable performance difference compared to the new 3DS. Like, I know I can get it running better though, because it used to run way worse than this, but since I'm only like 3 months into learning C++, I'm like learning new optimization techniques and getting it to run better and better, but there's a point in time where you just have to stop, take a break, and say this is good enough. I'll obviously finish stuff like audio and most of the blocks I forgot, but this project has been making me go insane for a while, and I don't want to have to wait 6 more months to upload a new video. So yeah, if you made it this far in the video, you're obviously kind of interested, so in the description there's a GitHub page to where you can download it and try it out, and if you find any bugs or crashes, let me know so I can fix it. So yeah, hopefully my next couple videos won't take as long as this one did to come out, because I am working on a couple of cool projects, so if you're not subscribed yet, then yeah, hit that subscribe button if you know what I'm saying.